called David is a Fag.
Yeah, how's it go?
It goes 1, 2, 3, 4. David is a fag, sucks a lot of dick. I'm just playing.
That sounds decent. It needs to work. It needs to be longer than a couple.
Oh, days. That's true. No, but the thing is Dan and I were coming up with, that wasn't like obviously anything. I just came up with that off the top of my head. But, the song that we're doing is, it sounds really cool. I think you'll like it. It's really driving. It's really, it's pretty good pace too. It's not like any kind of soft, it's not soft rock.
We're trying to church it up. Is it metal or is it pussy grandpa guitars?
It's metal on grandpa's guitars.
Who's playing what? Are you doing keyboard and guitar?
I'm doing keyboard and acoustic.
Okay. Well, yeah, you don't have an electric because you're fucking pussy. I'm impressed. I thought that all these years of you training to be a paramedic and not being into music anymore kind of gave you a little bit of a vagina, but I could feel some testosterone right there. I could feel it.
Yeah.
By the way, this is going to be a cold open. Like, all this is going into the show. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the second episode of A Conversation with David and Shawn. I'm David.
And I'm Shawn.
That's Shawn. And that's Shawn, everybody. So Shawn, a little bit behind the curve, but he just had his first kid. So let's give him a round of applause for that. I didn't think he had it in him.
I'll make mistakes.
But yeah, on his maternity leave, he actually was able to binge watch one of the best shows that's been out in recent memory, Daredevil. Netflix, yeah. Daredevil.
Yeah, I finally was able to have a life outside of work and
break away from the CW shows that you're addicted
to. Yeah, I'm not addicted. I mean,
I know.
I mean, in all fairness,
I'll cut you slack because you quit watching Flash and Arrow, something I haven't been able to do. I know I bitch you about it every week and that I need to quit watching it.
Per show, you're actually more addicted than me. So that's actually the pot calling the kettle black.
Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last episode of A Conversation. Is that going to be our catchphrase?
I think so. All right, this is going to be the last episode.
We need to print out t-shirts if we ever get a following that just says the last episode of A Conversation with David and Shawn.
Oh, my God.
Even if I can get my wife to wear it, it'd be worth it.
Maybe that should be what we call this thing. The last conversation between Shawn and David.
Maybe that's how I'm going to introduce the show. Welcome to the last ever episode.
Yeah. Oh, that's fucking great.
We'll see how it goes. Just like on the Life Thrice, you know, DVD, when they're halfway through their set, and they're just like, hey, I don't know if you guys know, but there's cameras, we're recording, and I don't know, I don't think we're doing too well, we might not even put this out. It's funny because the fans are like, oh, they're like, yeah, we're not doing too hot.
Right.
They're awesome. Well, speaking of which, you're going to see them tomorrow. Lucky bastard.
Oh, man. It's going to be great. As long as they don't play too much of the new album, it's going to be perfect.
I sent you the set list, so you know.
I know. So I know. It's going to be great. It's going to be.
I mean, they could play. They could just go out there and be silent. And I'm such a
dude. Fan. They fucking sold out, man.
Did they? Is that a sold out show?
Cool. Yeah, it's a sold-out show.
So, in case the audience is wondering, we are fans of excellent music. We have excellent music taste. If you're like, why aren't they talking about new rap? Or why aren't they talking about pop? When are you guys talking about Katy Perry? You can unsubscribe. She was a bad example. I don't mind Katy Perry.
Yeah, I mean, and she's hot, too, so.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, so, I mean. there's that.
So Daredevil. So what are your first? Did it live up to the hype? I know I hyped it up a lot. I don't know if anyone else hyped it up a lot. I know I fucking hyped it up, which I know
a lot of people hyped it up too, and it did. It did kill it a little bit for me, but I mean the hype did, but it still was a really good show though. I mean, it's rated on Netflix at like a 4.5, almost a 5. And
are you kidding me? Why is that? I've seen 5s that don't deserve it. Daredevil needs a 6.
That's funny, and not that I
can't complain because really, I don't pay for my Netflix account, but if I did, well, I'd be fucking furious.
That's funny. Not that I put too much stock in that, but there's some times where if I'm like, you know, we've all been there. Oh man, I'm gonna spend like 30 minutes fucking looking at Netflix to decide what to watch. Well, sometimes if it's got a high rating, I'm like, all right, I'll give it a shot.
Since we're living in the digital age now, I've actually been more selective. Like, I used to just finish a movie, no matter how bad it was. I'm like, I started it. But nowadays, there's so much content. If I'm not into it within the first 15 minutes, maybe that's unfair to some movies. I'm just done with it. Same thing with a TV show. If I'm not in it within the first episode or two, I know, like, the rule is you should always give an episode, like, 3 or 4 episodes. Or, sorry, you should always give a show 3 or 4 episodes.
Right, but,
like,
yeah.
I was watching Man Seeking Woman, which is a pretty decent comedy, and it had its moments, but I watched 2 episodes, and I'm like, okay, I get the tone for the show.
My thing, though, is a pilot should be what sells. I mean, it should be what sells.
But it's also made on such a budget for the majority. Like, Netflix, like, so, like, the Netflix shows, like, the pilots, I wouldn't even consider them pilots because they're already picked up and they're shot all in fucking, you know, like they're all shot at once.
But that is
like a normal pilot, yeah, like you don't know, like it could have been shot like a year ago on like a shoestring budget. That's why which is why sometimes like pilots have cast members that aren't in the series because the actors no longer available anymore when they finally greenlight the show.
Well, and it's funny because a pilot is what's supposed to just like really just rope you in and grab your attention. Like, take, for instance, it's not like an amazing show by any means, but Orange is the New Black. Season 1, episode 1, there's fucking titties everywhere, man.
It kind of like threw me through a loop because I'm like, all right, I can get down for this show.
And then I get to see titties.
I was like, great. I see a lot of lesbians eating each other out, but they all have their shirts on, so I don't know what's going on.
Well, and now, I mean, in season 2, there's like maybe 2 titties.
But they're on season 4 now, right? I haven't watched the show. I don't think it's all hyped up.
It's season 3 now, but I mean, yeah, but it's still a Netflix original, and that's kind of the point that it's supposed to rope you in, even though they've already paid for everything. It's supposed to be what brings you in, what really, you know. And Daredevil does a good job of it. I mean, in season 1, it is a little bit of a slow starter.
Both season
a little
premieres
bit.
I thought were good though. If I remember, season 1 is when he's fighting in the rain, fighting that dude in the rain, and it's super
badass.
And then season 2, they first episode ends with him fighting Daredevil, getting shot in the fucking head, right?
season 2 is by far better than season 1 as far as Daredevil.
Yes, but that's no joke. Yeah. But that's not to call season 1 a slouch by any stretch of the imagination.
No, it's not.
I remember being so impressed, and like, what's so cool about this show is I watched them like the week that they came out, both you know, seasons, because I heard such good things, and I'm just a comic book junkie.
And you're a Marvel fan like crazy,
I only own DC Comics, but I love Marvel too, though. I don't like the fanboy wars. They both are good in their own different ways.
I agree with that.
But
I mean,
DC's better now that we're getting down to the bottom of this.
Oh, no, because DC only focuses on like 2 fucking characters. I mean, where Marvel focuses on...
I guess maybe just the animated and live-action movies. There's the animated series, there's the games, but more importantly...
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, DC is only popular for 2 fucking people.
That's the thing we're talking about, people that are quote-unquote, like, fanboys, is, like, nobody ever references, like, the thing that everything's based off is the comics. Like...
Right.
I'm a fanboy of the comics. Like, nowadays, you can be, like, a comic book nerd, but, like, don't read comics. You just watch the movies and the shows, and I'm just like, oh, right on. It's way different.
That's why I don't call myself a guru of comic books. Like, I mean, I know the story of all the characters, especially in the Marvel and the DC worlds. I know what their backstories are. But do I have... you know, comic book number 10 of Captain America from 1950, whatever. No, I don't have all that. I've never read it. I'm not that much of a nerd. I don't collect them. And I don't know what version of you know, which writer said this and which writer did this version of it. I don't care. I mean, I like the premise of them, but
you're
I don't.
You're a lost soul, and I hope you enjoy your time in hell when you die, you fucking
hate okay, so this is the last episode of the conversation.
Whoa, yeah. I didn't say anything wrong. First off, you're going to hell because you're blasphemous as hell. You like to pretend like the Bible is fairy tale. I'm just playing. I don't want to get into any of this.
No, because...
But I'm with you, though.
Yeah.
and then you are definitely a fucking heathen, so all I do is fucking spit the truth. But no, what was so impressive about this show is that when fucking Daredevil Season 1 ended, Season 2 came out, like, within a year or a little bit over a year. Like, so they shot all of Season 2, which had so many, like, different moving parts to the... You know, basically, you know, to the story, and they had it out within a like. It's just, I just can't believe like how good a quality like the show is, and how quick they both came out from the time that they were shooting.
Yeah, I mean, in choreographing those fight scenes and having everything all written out, they had to have at least these two seasons already written, if not more than that.
From what I know, season two was kind of greenlit. And jump started, like they always plan on doing a season two, but it was kick started because season one, like the fucking like response and numbers they got back on it were like crazy. Because it was supposed to be when they first announced this, because they announced that they were gonna Marvel was teaming up like with Netflix, they were gonna do Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, and Iron Fist, and then they were gonna do the Defenders, which is like the street level New York City Avengers. But since Daredevil and then Jessica Jones as well is getting a second season, they just kind of like put all their eggs in the basket and did Daredevil season two even before doing Luke Cage, which is shooting right now, and then Iron Fist, which they've done the casting for. The guy who's playing Iron Fist is who's the queen? Not Melisandre. She's the Red Witch in Game of Thrones.
Who's
the queen? Who currently, my mind's blanking. Who's married to the worthless king or the worthless son of fucking Cersei's and Jaime? What's Tommen? Who's his wife?
Oh,
my mind's blanking. Natalie Dormer's character. Anyway, it's her brother, yeah. The guy who's gay, and that's why they're like locked in the prison with the High Sparrow. He's playing. Yeah. He's playing Iron Fist, which should be interesting. Because I don't see him as, like, an action hero. And that's what Iron Fist is. He's, like, a kung fu master.
I see him crying in a dungeon just, like, begging for...
Maybe that's why. Maybe, you know, he went to Game of Thrones and he was like, listen, fuckers. Like, I've been cast in a Marvel film. I need to work out and, like, fucking get myself in shape. You better write my character off in some dungeon or something because I ain't going to be there.
That's funny.
I would choose Game of Thrones over any of the Marvel, though. I feel like.
Oh, yeah.
Just for, like, you know, the experience. Like, Marvel is going to get you more in the limelight, and it's going to get you more. Like, anything Marvel will get you more. Like, I think it's going to progress your career further. But, God, like, how could you pass up Game of Thrones, though?
Are you sure, though, man? Because I'm sure the guy who played Ramsay Bolton got a career in just about whatever he wants to do.
No, everyone's going to be like, you're Ramsay and I hate your ass, and you're never getting this job. He's like, but that's just the character. They'll say, we don't give a fuck.
Like that, and then he can be like, well, that's how good I am as an actor, because I'm able to be universally hated so well.
Absolutely. Just like, you've seen the movie The Patriot, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so the villain in that movie, I don't know the actor's name in real life, but he also plays, in Harry Potter, he plays Lucius Malfoy, who's a bastard too, and that doesn't help him. But even other than fucking Harry Potter, anything that he's in, even if he's not a villain, he was such a bastard in that movie that I just can't not hate him. Like, anytime I see him pop up, I'm like, I hate you.
Right,
I want you
to
die. Even if it's like a romantic comedy, I'm like, someone just kill him.
Yeah.
He just needs to go.
And that's funny because, I mean, have you ever gone back and watched the Mel Gibson movie now? Because all I see
is Yeah. I love The Patriot. I try to watch it once every couple of years. Christina had never seen it, so we watched it. It's really long. But God, I would consider that my
those are such good movies. But now, like, all I see is Mel Gibson's racist blue eyes. That's all I see.
Him racing to try to beat his wife. He's just like, I gotta get done with this Revolutionary War. I got a wife to beat, and then she died, and then I'm gonna marry her sister, and she's gonna get it. That was a fucking weird part of the movie. Anyway,
and I'm gonna hate Jews and black people. Yeah,
so back to Daredevil.
I'm at it,
and not Mel Gibson.
I know, we keep getting off track.
So, I mean, okay, so, I mean, my thoughts, so, you liked it, obviously. I remember coming off the high of finishing the first, the last episode of season one, and being like, this show's fucking incredible. And then the same thing with season two, but I was just like, season two was so good, and then fucking compared to season one, or with season one, as that the series, we have two seasons in a series. If you would have asked me, like, the day that I watched it, I would have called it my favorite show of all time. Now that I've had months to process it, I would say it's number two. I would say it's either number two or number three. With The Shield and fucking Game of Thrones.
I would say it's, I mean, of those three, I would have put it number three. Yeah. But then again,
but it's I'm only not season gonna... two, though. So, like, if what yeah. if what if fucking Daredevil keeps this quality up for, like, six more seasons, then it's definitely, which is why I didn't give it my number
one. I still like the story of The Shield and Game of Thrones better than
what's going on in Hell's Kitchen. One thing that Daredevil does, though, is it does better than both those shows, because even though I consider both those shows pretty much flawless, I literally don't have any valid complaints against Daredevil. I know you were talking, and we can get that one complaint out of the way. You were fucking... Because you always go with heroes and their fucking ethics about killing people. You want everyone just to kill everybody.
Well, I don't want that. But my thing, though, is when he's on the rooftop and he's talking to the Punisher and he says, well, this time, you know what, you're right. Let's just go. It's okay to go your way. Hang on,
I'm confused. I thought that was on the boat when he said that, when they found maybe, out who the blacksmith was. Because the rooftop scene.
You're right. I'm sorry.
He's in the boat. Yeah.
Yeah, I just had it in my head because of that rooftop scene was so fucking cool.
Wasn't that amazing?
That was excellent dialogue. Very well done. But yeah, he's sitting there and he's talking to him. Yeah, it was on the boat because he just stopped him from killing that guy.
To try to find out who the blacksmith was.
Right.
Yeah, well, because the guy on the boat, if I remember, was just wanting to die, and he's like, I'm the blacksmith. And, like,
yeah.
Fucking Daredevil showed up, he's like, you know that he's just lying to you because he's scared. And fucking Frank Castle, in a really good, like, fucking thing of acting, was just like, why couldn't you just let me have this? Like,
right.
You know, like, I know he's lying, but if you wouldn't have kind of brought it to light, I just would have, you know, so... I just needed it. But yeah, no, but you're right, though. Like, before the boat blew up and the gang ascended on the boat, he did say, we'll just do it your way, we'll kill, but Frank Castle says, no, it's not that easy, Red. If you fucking do this, there's no coming back. You can't just do it once. You have to, you know, it's something, it just fucking changes you. And once you kill, like, that's just who you are. So well, I think at that moment...
He does this whole little, like, religious cross thing across yeah. his chest, the whole Catholic thing. And I'm like, well, okay, that's fine. You can say that, but like you said, once you cross that threshold, you can never come back. And my thing is you are essentially okay with killing if you're okay with cover sniper fire on a rooftop at the very end. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. He's just going to kill him. You're okay with killing there.
I think that was fan service. I don't think they thought too much into the story. I thought that was, hey, during the final battle, how cool would it be if Frank Castle showed up and shot some people?
Yeah, but at the same time, if he's going to say, well, we'll do it your way, that means he's essentially okay with killing. Why didn't he kill that last guy? I mean, he's being a pussy and not dirtying his own hands. Well, and my thing is...
That's true.
Yeah, it just is. And that's my biggest issue with him, is that he's okay with somebody else doing the dirty work, but not himself. And my thing is that's a half measure. And not only that, it just proves that religion gets in the way. That's all it does. Just religion. Oh, religion
welcome
just holds
to,
you back.
Welcome to Bashing Religion with David and Shawn, where every episode we bring up a topic, but it all circles back to how we don't like organized religion.
pretty much, yeah. I'm just saying, where would we be if we didn't have religion? A lot fucking further. We'd be in space right now. We'd be on Mars. We'd be doing all kinds of shit.
I've seen Total Recall.
Stem cells.
I don't know if that works out in our benefit. There's mutant people, chicks with three boobs. You have to pay for oxygen.
Are you sure, though? Like, three boobs are better than two.
No, because I would be... Is just like Benny the cab driver, I would be so fucking conflicted. I'd be like, baby, this makes me want to have three hands. And, like, I literally, like... I guess you could mutate yourself somehow because there's all those mutants in the fucking in Mars. Anyway, that's a classic.
Yeah, but like tits are nature's pillows, so you can never have enough.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Have it, and I'm sure that you can relate since you both have newborns.
intense. Oh, dude, we're not seeing any titty action at all.
And I mean, like, if you see the process, it's kind of, I don't know, like, you gotta wait, like, I think I remember waiting a couple, like, it might have even been 6 months after my first kid, to where they were, like, appealing again. Because, man, those kids do fucking damage.
Oh, man, I know. We all make mistakes. I'm just playing.
I'm telling you.
I don't want Atticus to see this, like, 10 years from now and be like, Dad called me a mistake.
That's fine. I mean, he's gonna hear worse.
That's true. I'm gonna tell him.
He's gonna hear worse. I can't wait to meet him. I'm gonna be like the drunken uncle who's just like, you're lucky that you just didn't end up on your mom's face like all your other brothers and sisters. But no, so get back. Okay, so that's your one complaint. Or is that your one complaint? Is that your only complaint against Daredevil versus this killing?
Well, not only that, their blatant attempt to refuse to say the word fuck.
It's a Disney show, Sean.
I don't
even
give
though
a shit.
It is hard. It went so much further than I expected it to for it being a Marvel Daredevil.
I don't care
series.
Because if they're gonna kill people and they're gonna torture people, then why can't you say the word fuck? Because it's I cringe. I just cringe a little bit.
In the Marvel movies, they kill people and torture people. In Civil War, they do a scene where a Hydra agent has a guy upside down.
So God forbid you're torturing someone. They could have short of waterboarded this guy, but for some reason they think that that is worse than saying the word fuck. It completely throws off the dialogue.
You have a legit complaint because now you're just nitpicking and
No, I'm not. It's not.
You're just like, this show didn't say fuck.
No, but if you hear me out though, you have all these hardened criminals that can say shit, ass, I mean almost pretty much everything else, but they cannot say the word fuck. And in times where it would be more appropriate to say that, because like what hardened criminal in the jail is gonna be like, ow, screw you? Like, no, it doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Yeah. It sounds terrible, to be honest with you. And it makes me cringe a little bit. Other than that, though, the dialogue was great especially between Foggy and Murdoch. Wow. I mean, dude, there's so many great things. Literally my only complaint, that they just will not use the word fuck. And maybe they're not allowed to.
No, they're not allowed to. It's Disney, Sean.
Well, I'm sorry. It's on Netflix. There's plenty of shows on Netflix. It's a Netflix original. They can do whatever the fuck they want.
But Disney's
they do it
in the bill, though, sir.
Well, Disney
and
can stop being a bunch of
and
pansies.
It's tied into Iron Man. Like, they literally reference, like, the War of New York, which is cool. I like how they don't call it Alien Invasion. They just call it, like, you know, the event. Then don't go have them,
ow, screw you. Like, don't have them do that.
I honestly never thought about it. Like, I was just surprised they, like, showed Frank Castle shooting a dude's face off with a shotgun at point-blank range.
Dude, and my thing is they will show stuff like that, but they can't. My thing is I would rather have my son hear the word fuck 20 times then show him someone getting their face blasted off. I'm sorry. I think that is way worse.
It's the opposite of the whole part of the South Park movie where she's just like, where fucking Kyle's mom's like, violence and nudity on TV is okay as long as there's no naughty language.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
That is
exactly.
Our rating system is fucked up. And maybe that can be a topic for another time, because that would be interesting, because it is weird that you can say fuck once in a PG-13, but you say fuck twice and it's rated R. Show a ton of violence as long as there's not bloodshed. For instance, like the Max Payne movie is rated PG-13, the rated R cut I bought on DVD. And it's no different. They just have the blood digitally in. I'm like, oh, I guess you can show people getting massacred as long as there's no bloodshed, or not excessive bloodshed. You can still cuss, but you can't say fuck more than twice. It's really fucking weird. You can even show nudity.
Yeah. I just think the rating system is like you said, very flawed. Well, and I think a word should not dictate whether or not. Because my thing is dialogue for me is huge. Plot driven stories. And shows and dialogue is really what makes
this show doesn't masterfully.
No, it does such a good job. It really does. And my favorite conversations are really, especially when Foggy finds out who Matt really is. And
which is, what, the last three episodes of season one?
No.
He finds out in season one, because it carries over into season two, right?
I thought...
Yeah, because he comes after him in Stick Fight, and Foggy goes and sees his apartment just completely fucked.
Yeah. And I just think that the dialogue, and Foggy has just like become really one of my favorite characters, only because he's so logical and so practical.
He's my favorite character. And man, like, yeah. He fucking steps up. Like, so what I love about the show is that, especially in season 2, where a show with 13 episodes could have become so messy because you have the Frank Castle, like, you're introducing his character, and you're continuing Matt Foggy and Karen's adventures. You have Fisk in jail, which was a surprise. You have the whole, you have basically, you know, Elektra and Stick and their backstory, and then you have, like, the Hand and all that shit. You have all these moving pieces, and they could have been so messy because, like, courtroom drama normally doesn't mix with, like, ancient fucking ninjas. Like, but they weave it in so well that none of it feels like it overtakes anything else. And they do have, and like everybody has their moments. Like you said, Foggy has his moments. Like that moment that we were talking about earlier on the phone when he is when the disbanding basically like they're disbanding their friendship and like basically dissolving like their company. And he goes back for like one last word, and Matt just is like, "No, I'm just gonna let you go." And Foggy's like, what does Matt say? Matt says like, "Hey, were you hoping that I would actually say yes, that we should stay together?" He's like, "I was kind of hoping so, but so like relieved when you didn't." Like just lines right. like that just like got me like, man, this is, it's so much better than anything else in television for the most
part. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's kind of like your best friend from high school or from way back when. You know that someone is probably not good for you, and you would stay with them because you love them, and you want to. And life is so much more fun, but you know, in the long run, things are better for you.
Yeah, I mean, they did a good job of showing what Foggy had passed up to be in his partnership with Matt, and then also did a good job with the flashbacks. Because like, on like a certain Arrow show where flashbacks are like meaningless, like this show used them sparingly. The flashbacks were like excellent. The flashbacks of Matt getting his powers and training, and the flashbacks of Fisk as a kid being abused and killing his dad. And then you had the flashback of Matt and Foggy as like college kids, and you saw like how like they were just like, they were just not so in love, but
they had their inside jokes.
Close. Yeah, they were close still.
They had inside jokes. Yeah, and what I really, one of my favorite things about the show is, especially in season 1, they show Fisk and how his dad told him to go stare at the wall, and then his dad starts beating his mom because he didn't have any faith in him. And as he's just beating the shit out of his mom, Fisk comes up with a hammer and hits his dad in the head and basically like kills him. I mean, it's pretty fucking brutal.
That was brutal.
Yeah, I mean, and my thing is they did a good job of transitioning that to... now he looks at that same wall, or a wall that looks very similar to it, the same wall that his dad told him to stare at, and he's like, because, hey, you need to stare at this wall until you become a man.
He's fucked and up psychologically, obviously.
Well, I mean, you got to think, though, like I've always said, man, any show is going to let you sympathize a little bit, not fully, but just a little bit with the main villain.
Which you have to. If you don't sympathize with your characters, they're just boring. Like, he's just...
Yeah.
He would just be, like, a trolling... Or he would just be, like, a mustache-trolling villain with no reason for you to care about him. But Fisk... Right. Yeah, but they did. They showed how he's mentally damaged. And, honestly, it makes his actions make more sense because he...
Yeah, it does.
Like, he tries so hard to have this, like, you know, facade of being calm and relaxed. But really, he's just a big kid inside who's still dealing with a bunch of messed up shit. But he knows from his father that he has to take control and step up and be overly violent. But at the same time, he's just a kid lashing out. And there's so many layers to him that when you think about it, like, every character in the show has these layers that are just so fucking excellent.
I mean, just like when he looks, every time he looks at himself in the mirror in the morning, he sees himself as a kid with the blood all over his face. That right there is powerful. And that says a lot about who he is. And what he's been through has shaped him as a person.
So, were you shocked to see Fisk was in season 2? Because going into it, I had no idea.
Actually, no. Actually, I actually expected it because I knew he was going to jail. So I'm like, well, that's a perfect opportunity to put Fisk in the middle of it. And when I saw, and I was actually a little bit concerned because I'm like, really, is the Punisher going to basically take away all of his morality or his quote-unquote code that he has to work with an asshole like Fisk?
Because he totally could have gotten off, right?
Yeah.
But he threw his court case.
Yeah, and
to go there because Fisk got to him, correct? Is that what happened?
Well, basically, Fisk just used him and was going to kill him afterwards.
Yeah. But, I mean, I could get him to the prison. Like, he got word to Frank Castle. He wanted to meet with him, right? So that's why Fisk threw his trial. Because I thought Foggy was winning that. Foggy and Matt were both winning it. Like, Foggy did a lot of it, but I thought Matt's ending, his ending, statement or whatever you call it.
Closing statement?
Closing statement. Sorry, I'm not a lawyer.
Yeah.
yet. But yeah, but that was really good. I think he had, I think they had the jury sold. And, oh my God, speaking of which, I love that scene where they called up his old commanding officer from the army, and he told that story, and she tried to, the fucking district, attorney tried to play it off, and she's like, oh yeah, well, who was this guy? He's like, that was me. And it's like, fuck. And I don't think she said shit. I think she just sat down. She's like, fuck.
Yeah, she did. She's like, no further remarks.
Yeah, yeah. God, they do lawyer, even, the lawyer scenes, even the fucking courtroom drama scenes in this show are better done than, actual courtroom drama shows. Like, this show is just, A-plus all around. I can't believe it. I was so hooked. I'm like, I could see these guys in court. Like, I could see a spinoff. Fuck fucking Jessica Jones season 2. Fuck Luke Cage and the Young Defenders. Just give me Matt Murdock not being superheroes, just doing court stuff.
That's funny. I think it'd be really cool if they integrated Foggy into Jessica Jones's.
I hope.
We'll see. I mean, same universe. Yeah. I mean, Foggy works for the same company now that Jessica Jones indirectly worked
for. Claire, the doctor, she was the only connecting tissue between Daredevil and Jessica Jones, because she was the one that they brought Luke Cage to after Luke Cage, shot himself with the fucking shotgun, point blank in the face or some shit.
Yeah. And I think she's a nurse, actually.
Nurse. But she quit her job, though, which is cool because in the comics, Jessica Jones and Luke Cage are together, and I think they might get married. I mean, the shit gets rewritten all the time. But I think Claire actually hooks up with Luke Cage as well. So that'd be cool if she was in his series, because I like her, and I like the actress that plays her, Rosario Dawson. And she was underused in the season. I like all the side plot stuff, but her, quitting her job and standing up against, them trying to cover up, the ninja attacks, I'm like, was that necessary? But I liked seeing her on screen, so I didn't think it was, I didn't think it was a complete negative. But
yeah, she's pretty hot, back too, on it, so.
Oh, yeah, of course. Rosario Dawson's gorgeous. speaking of which, you should watch the movie Trance with her and James McAvoy. Full frontal is all I'll say, and shave.
All right.
I would just send you the screenshot. There's no need to watch movies anymore for that stuff. You just Google. God, we're jumping all around, but there's just so much shit to talk about. We haven't talked about Electra though. We talked on the phone when you watched the first couple episodes, and how good the Punisher story fleshed out for you.
I think honestly the Punisher was the most interesting part about season 2, even more so than Elektra. Yeah, she was interesting, but
I would agree completely. Way more interesting. Yeah. They both had their places, and I liked how the Punisher, even after he got arrested in episode 4, I was like, is he over?
He was
interweaving. Basically, they're all in every episode, which I think is fucking done so well.
Yeah, and then they basically put Elektra being the Black Sky, or not the Black Sky, but the what do you call her?
I think it is the Black Sky. It's not the Black Sky. It's the Black Sky. Which is funny. They never explained what it is, and me being a comic fan, I'm like, should I know what the Black Sky is? And I was looking it up on Google, and I think it's new to the show, or they haven't explained it in the comics, even if it is referenced.
I took it as a person who achieves immortality, because that's what they were talking about when Stick was talking about the biggest war of all, and it's over immortality. They found the secret to eternal life, and I think that she might have something to do with that, or at least be the key to it. I don't have any real evidence on
that.
They're
gonna bring her back, so maybe. But I mean, her ass died, so is that we've put all our chips in the wrong basket?
I personally don't have any evidence to prove this, but it's just more of a feeling. Plus, she's really talented, super hot, so they're probably gonna bring her back.
She has a really good mix of beautiful and like cute at the same time. Like, you know, some girls are just cute and beautiful, and some girls are just sexy. She's like a pert mix between like all of them. And a really good actress.
Yeah. My wife's pretty much both of those, so yeah.
In case my wife's listening, she's all three as well.
Yeah. Which they're not going to listen, so it doesn't matter.
No. Just like I remember on our first thing we did together, the X-Men Apocalypse review, we fucking caught ourselves out for being gay, and we're like, everybody's never found out. They got to sit through 30 minutes of X-Men talk before.
Yeah, and they never
before they never do it. But yeah, no, I really liked Elektra's story. How did you feel about like the flashbacks of her and Stick? Like, I thought, like, one of my only small downsides, besides there's a couple weak parts of the last episode, but so like ends up Stick is like protecting her, but he knows like what she is and what the hand wants with her. Like, wouldn't you think that like there's no like chance for her to live? Like, because, like, you know, Stick seems really rational, and Stick seems like he just does what he needs to do, just like Magneto does. Like, he'll kill fucking Mystique.
I think there's two reasons why they had that, and one was because it shows relevancy to her and Murdoch itself. Because why did he leave Murdoch? Probably because he learned that he's now emotionally attached to somebody like her. So that's why he's like, well, I know you made that cute little bracelet, kid, but you're going to have to go ahead and fuck off because I can't deal with that bullshit. I've already dealt with this bullshit before. So I think that's why he is the way he is. So it has character development for Stick. It explains his actions on why he was with Murdoch. And now he's shown himself to be a little bit weak when it comes to Elektra. So, I think it's relevant. I think it was well done.
I mean, it was really well done when she was murdering that kid and shit. That was like, man, she's just a killer. And like, I feel like Stick knew the whole time. But it brings back like another question. So like, when Stick turns on Elektra and sends those two assassins after her, and she kills them both really easy, and she's like, oh, these are Stick's guys. It's like, well, why did, if, like, fucking Stick risked everything to save her and protect her, why would he randomly just be like, well, it's done, I can't do anything more, I'm just going to try to kill her? Like, that just seemed like a little...
I think maybe it's hard, and the only thing I can say to that...
Like, most of the time, the answer is because of story reasons.
No, I mean, but I could find logic in it, too. Because imagine you trying to kill a child versus an adult. That's got to be way harder. And then he even said himself... during the flashback, he's like, I'm basically trying to prolong this inevitability for as long as possible. When he has the... Yeah, so I think he's just trying to prolong it.
That's why you're on the show, because you watched it recently. And I'm just kind of like going through my memories. I do love how she tried to kind of, you know, confirm for him. But then when that, like, assassin kid is in Maddox... is in Murdoch's, like, apartment... And she comes and just, like, slits his throat, and she's covered in blood, and she's like, oh, do you still love me? I was like, damn.
That's crazy.
That was crazy.
No. I would have been like, that's fucking hot. That's awesome. And to be honest with you, I think he's fucking stupid, to be honest with you. If somebody came in my fucking house, I would kill him.
Yeah.
I mean, any logical person would do that. And she even said herself.
He's a superhero.
I don't give a fuck who you are, man. You're still, like, you're a logical person. America,
you're in my property. Even if he has my property, you kill him, you drag him inside.
Drag his fucking ass inside and say he came in my house. Break a window on the outside to make it look like intrusion happened.
And you say that blood trail was already there when you got home.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, but no. My thing is
That was so well done, though, because wasn't that the ending of an episode? Like, kind of like a cliffhanger?
Yeah, but my thing, though, is if it was me, I would have done the same fucking thing. And maybe I'm a terrible person, but my thing is, if someone has threatened my life, at the end of the day, it's either me or him. And I'm not so idealistic to say that, oh, well, I can't kill anybody because God and Catholicism and Jesus. No, fuck that. It's me or him.
I did like his struggle with that, though, with him and him being, you know, religious. They didn't touch too much on it in the second season, I didn't think. But the first season, I really liked and, you know, like, enjoyed all the conversations between him and the minister, who I'm pretty sure knew. I know he knows in the second season. But in the first season, he knew he was Daredevil, right?
I think he has an idea. I can't remember for sure if he actually knows for sure. I think he does. But, yeah, I mean, my thing, though, is if someone is coming to your house as a trained assassin, can slow their heartbeat, and it's literally penetrated your chest with an arrow, a poison arrow at that, and has had made a direct attempt on your life, I think that is ludicrous not to try to kill that person because A, they know where you live, B, they've already made an attempt on your life, and C, it's just plain
Well, it showed that
self-defense.
kid following Elektra, right? Didn't it show him like trailing her like the whole episode or
Yeah.
something like that?
And she's like, "Oh, he's just a kid. I'm sorry. If you're able to fight like that kid is, you're not a fucking kid. You're a fucking killer."
You're a thing of the
And
hand.
I'm sorry. I don't have any sympathy for you if you're able to do that.
So, what did you feel? How did you feel about the villain Naboo? I think his name was, who was the ninja he fought in the first season. He got really fucked
Right.
up by, but then he caught him on, but then he lit him on fire and killed his ass. Or so you thought. I thought it was cool that they brought him back, but also a little weird that they retconned him because he was. Like from the first season, I took him as like a hired hand, but then I felt like they retconned it in this season. We're like, oh, now he's like the leader, and I'm like, well, I don't think he was the leader. Like I think that like it felt a little forced, but it was still cool though. Just like you said, the ending where he quote unquote doesn't kill him but lets him drop is a little lame, but then it was cool that Stick got him. Like I think that made up for it.
And the thing is I wish that for more character development and to kind of further the conflict within Maddox. I mean, you can disagree, and I know the comics say that he can't kill, but
I
my
heard you just say fucking Maddox, which is what we should
uh,
call him. Can we just call him
Oh, I'm
Maddox for the
sorry.
rest of this
Murdoch. I'm
podcast?
sorry.
No,
Murdoch.
I want to
That's
call him
funny.
Maddox.
That's
All
funny.
right.
I've been listening to too
The best
much
Daredevil
to.
in the universe. Maddox.
I've been listening to too much Maddox. But no, but Matt basically says, "All right, well, I'm okay with killing." And then he throws him off a roof, which would kill any normal person.
But he knows that
And
this fucker regenerates.
I yeah, so. My thing is, he's really walking that line of killing and not killing, but he's able to set him on fire, which would kill a normal
Oh
person. He
man,
had respiratory
that was a
burns.
life that like he was about to die. Like he was getting super fucked up. Which
Right.
God, can we touch on the fact that I love how that episode so logically introduces him wanting to get the armor because. For these superhero movies and shows, it's always about like how are you gonna like explain why they wear a cape and a giant ass on their chest? Like you always have to have a logical reason.
Right.
So I thought that was awesome, and I liked how they kept, basically how they kept him in contact with that guy, even in fucking season two. Like, and he has his little tics, and he's kind of like off a little bit. But I liked how Madoc.
I thought he was. I know the R word is frowned
He
upon, but I thought he
was
was fucking
retarded.
retarded.
Yeah, no, he might have autism. I know he's a comic, or I know he's a character in the comic, but I don't know anything about him. So yeah, I mean, he's off. He has his tics. He has autism,
Or maybe it's
Asperger's.
like, yeah, I
He
was
might
gonna
be
say maybe
fucking
it's a
retarded. I don't know.
could be Asperger or something. I don't know. You can't say the R word anymore because again, we live in a
I
pussified
just said it.
society.
He might be fucking retarded.
Yeah.
The thing with that word is that if you use it as an insult, then it's bad, but words are just meaningless. Just like I was listening to like an
Well, I don't mean it as
interview.
an insult. I mean it as
Yeah.
what he actually is.
I was listening to like an interview with the guy from fucking Britain, and he was just like, one of the biggest things I had to do when I came over here is I couldn't ask people for a fag anymore because people get so irate. And like that just goes to show. And then like they use like cunt, cunt is just like calling someone like an asshole or something,
Right.
or like even less than that, even just like, hey dude, like or whatever. So it's like
Well,
words
I
are just
mean,
like it's all about the power.
over here, cunt is just like the end all be all. Like, if you call a woman a bitch, so like, whatever. But if you call them a
Dude, I
cunt,
don't
oh
know.
man.
If we were to, I mean, and granted, I guess like I'm not a female, so I can't contest, but like I think bitch, because you can say it with such emphasis, you can say you fucking bitch. Like I feel like that would like if I was a girl, like if someone was saying that, like I feel like that would offend me more than being called a cunt, because like
I think
cunt, you
that.
can't put any emphasis on it. It's just because it's like thing at the end.
Well, no, because bitch has been used so much, and it's been used as like almost like an term of endearment in a lot of the ghetto culture. So, oh man,
And
she's
I
my
mean, women call each
bitch.
other bitches all the time. Like, I'm gonna go hang out with my bitch
Yeah,
friends. So,
or
agreed.
it's. Yeah, so, but like, oh, you
Agreed.
can't say, oh, she's my cunt. Like, you can't say
Nope.
that.
Just like in fucking Clerks 2, when he's like, I'm gonna start bringing back porch monkeys. I'm gonna take it back. We're gonna take back Hunt, me and you. We're gonna start it.
We're
Hi,
gonna
welcome to our
take back
conversation
porch
with David and Sean, where we sit here and talk about our cunts.
Yeah, and we take back the word cunt,
Yeah, we take
because
back
if we use it, then we bring back the power.
So we keep going so far down the rabbit hole. I have no idea where we were even fucking. Oh, Stick. I was glad that he killed Naboo, because the fucking torture scene where he's getting the bamboo shoved in his fingertips, he needed retribution for that.
Yeah.
Do you remember that? You remember. You just watched the episode.
Of course. I mean, how do you forget
that?
That
was fucking brutal, but of course, they didn't say fuck, so it's invalid, no matter how much cool the show.
Oh, man, come on, man. You have to at least give me that one
thing.
Yeah,
that's true. He probably would have said, fuck, this hurts pretty bad. He didn't actually cry. He didn't actually scream or do anything, didn't he? He just took it like a stick and was like, I ain't crying.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, man. I have accidentally... like tried to pick up a piece of paper off of a table and got a splinter in my fucking.
Cunt. We're taking it back.
Oh man, yeah, in my cunt. No, in my underneath my fingernail, and man, I almost screamed in so much pain. I couldn't even imagine being tortured like that. No. That just.
I want to point this out to the audience, but in the bottom right hand corner, I just noticed you have your Buster Sword from Final Fantasy VII laying on the ground.
Oh
just
yeah,
just like it's commonplace. You're like, I just have my Buster Sword on the ground. Just don't.
Well, I mean,
don't mind that.
It's just in case someone breaks into my house so I can slit their throat with it.
So, I mean, we can start to wrap this up. I know, like, there's so much we haven't touched on, but, like, we don't have hours and hours and hours. And if we broke down every episode, we could. But overall, I mean, it's such a good fucking show. I think it sets a standard. That's why I didn't like Jessica Jones as much. Because even though Jessica Jones was really good in its own right,
yeah.
The fact that it's fucking... Like, the fact that it takes place in the same universe and it's, you know, connected to story-wise with Daredevil, you can't help but to compare it. Like, it made me, like, not like Jessica Jones as much because I'm like, there's filler. Like, Daredevil, I can't stress on this enough, there's no filler. There's no, nothing's not important, and you have so many moving pieces.
Ah, man.
And everybody's important. Everyone has their moments. The dialogue's great. Fucks or no fucks.
I was just about to bring that up real fast. But one thing that I wanted to cover with Jessica Jones is that the dialogue seems tired because Jessica's always. I understand you've been.
She's a. She's a giant cunt, and you can't relate to a character who's sarcastic.
No, and I understand, like, you've been raped physically and mentally.
And I liked when they touched on that, like, because it's a story about a rape victim. I'm like, that's unique and that's really cool.
Yeah, and I understand that,
but
like,
she needs
everything
to be serious
sometimes.
She's just sarcastic the whole time.
Right, and everything is just some tired comment of.
Which is why I could never be a movie character, because nobody would like me, because I'd be Jessica Jones.
man, but everything is the sarcastic, tired, I'm sick of life type thing. And I'm sorry, but I mean, it's okay for the first couple episodes, but it's always the same thing with her.
Let's be honest, the villain saves the episode. Or like,
yes.
Or not the episode, like the series. Like the episode with Kilgrave are excellent. All the parts that I can complain about are the parts where he's not in it.
But like, there's no awesome fight scenes in Jessica Jones like there are in Daredevil.
No, the
I mean, the
fight
all...
scene actually pissed me off because like Jessica Jones has shown that she can leap far, and like so spoilers for Jessica Jones season 2, she snaps his neck, but while he's controlling people to like rip each other apart, and she's trying to stop people. But it's like, you can run past him, you can jump over them, just run up and snap his neck. Like, why are you so?
Concerned about
hesitant.
Everybody else.
And I know it was just... a draw it out, but like that's shitty CW writing. Like, oh, let's have this random event happen that doesn't make any sense and like draw it out. Fucking Daredevil, like I never felt like I was being struggled along in Daredevil. I never felt like something was thrown in there just to stretch out the story. Like, it all was just moved.
The fight scenes, and it's so, I mean, I can only imagine the rehearsal that it took to get to this point, but the fight scenes were so well rehearsed and well done.
Because each season has the
tracking
shot.
Yeah, and everything was just one continuous shot, just the whole way.
Just one fight scene per season, right? You had the hallway fight scene in the first season, and then you had the stairwell fight scene in the second season, which they're both fucking so awesome. The stairwell fight scene, I think, is better.
No,
but
it is better.
I like the second one because you see Because you never see him really get tired, I don't think. And maybe my memory's off on the second one. But in the hallway fight scene, I loved how you saw him tire out and then get adrenaline boost and then tire down again. I'm like, that's so fucking cool. And it's realistic as it can be for a blind guy to do what he's doing.
Well, I mean, it's realistic for anybody. I did wrestling in high school, and the matches were only a couple minutes apiece, and you had three matches. And I remember just after the first match alone, 2 minutes doesn't sound like a long time, but man, if you're giving it everything you have for just 2 minutes, after that, you're like, oh my God, I'm about ready to fucking die. Don't use everything
you got and then wrestling, because I can't help to think of wrestling from South Park, where like the kids just think they're like groping other dudes, and they're just
of course.
And they think that real wrestling is the drama shit on WWE, where they're just like, I had 2 abortions by the time I was 10. They're like, man, that's the best wrestling I've ever seen.
Holy shit.
South Park, oh my God.
But I'm just relating this to Daredevil that, man, it would be...
The fact that you used to wrestle and grab dudes' dicks.
Yeah, I mean... Worn out. Well, exactly. It's a lot of effort grabbing dudes' dicks. But,
with a dick or two.
I mean, I just imagine trying to fight... With every just throwing punches, taking punches, and that fight scene was a long fucking time too. And you would be so exhausted. Even if you're in the best shape of your life, they equate 2 minutes of wrestling, and I can imagine taking it to fighting, but they equate 2 minutes of wrestling up to like running up to five miles, and because that's how exhausted you are after it, because you're using every muscle,
because you have to like stroke the shaft while you're fucking tugging. Like I mean, I don't know all the ins and outs of wrestling, but you gotta
cup the balls.
Yeah, say I say it's yeah. Like you can't ignore the
one
balls.
One finger goes in the anus while you're cupping the balls. I mean, come on, man.
What I hear, I'm not a wrestler, but I hear it's hard to find where the anus is through like the fucking latex that you guys are in, so like that's why you guys are always like running around on the ground and rolling around, man, and shit.
If you can't find the anus, I feel so bad for your wife. I feel so bad.
No comment. But going back on your no killing thing, it is funny during the rooftop fight scene after Daredevil has the gun duct taped to his hand and he's just like, kill the dude. He's like, I'm not gonna do it. When all those bikers are coming down the hallway, Daredevil tries to take a shot. And he's like, fuck, it's not loaded. Like, the fucking Punisher set me up. But he fucking still took the shot. Like, he was going to try to shoot somebody. And then he does the chain thing.
Doesn't make sense, because he fucking took the one shot to break off the chain so he could get free to begin with. So that doesn't make sense.
My memory might be deceiving me, but I thought he tried to take a shot and he realized it was empty. Didn't he?
I think so. When you watch so many episodes at once, you're just like, shit, what happened now?
No, this show, Netflix, like the whole Netflix binging model is just, it's so
well, bad, and that's why I try not to cover things chronologically. I just try to cover the whole show as a show, just because, I mean, I'm going to be honest with you, my memory is not good enough to remember every detail of 13 hours, because you're essentially trying to remember 13 hours, because every...
Yes.
I mean, really, and for me, it was 26 hours because I watched both of them back. Yeah, that's 26. Try to remember everything
season
that happened.
Season 1, we didn't even touch. This has been more of a season 2 discussion. Yeah, I mean, R.I.P. Ben.
But we did cover how Fisk. But we did cover Mr. Fisk and all of his developments too.
We didn't cover Ben though, the best character. R.I.P. Ben got his fucking ass strangled after he talked to Fisk's mom.
Yeah.
Oh,
well.
So now, because I remember, I was talking to you. We haven't talked since you finished the show, but we talked like, we were talking, I think like episode 4 when Punisher was going to jail. I'm like, I can't wait to see where this goes. Like the prison fight scene was brutal as fuck. My favorite part of the show, but you saw like Fisk, how he's like becoming the Kingpin. Cause I remember you were talking about how you were like, why don't they call him Kingpin? I'm like, he has to kind of become the Kingpin.
And he does in jail because he's like, there can only be one Kingpin.
Yeah.
When he kills the quote unquote kingpin of the jail, which was kind of cool because they were leading up to that anyway with the card that Ben has that he puts the king up there with a question mark inside the card.
But no, I mean Fisk, he was used sparingly, but fuck man, when he sets up the Punisher in that fucking prison fight scene, And maybe it's just because, like, everything was so bright and they were all in white suits and, like, the walls and shit were white. But that was so fucking overly violent. Like, I loved it.
There's no such thing as overly violent.
No. I mean, things like fucking anime and Kill Bill with the spraying blood is
that's just for... me
because I want that in every movie now. Like, isn't that you're?
I don't know.
For years, I don't know. Shawn's a paramedic, and Shawn's gonna contest whether or not that's how arteries work. Is that how they work, Shawn?
It's not gonna be Kill Bill. That's for damn sure.
Well, then, I don't know what you're doing. I don't know what you're doing. Like, obviously, you're fucking doing your job wrong.
I got nothing for that. to say that.
But yeah, and then you get like Kingpin actually fight or Fisk or you know actually fighting the fucking Punisher, who actually kind of like gets in a couple of good shots, which is fucking excellent. And I think that's cool and that's important because it sets up their relationship. Because in the comics, like they're at ends, obviously. Like everyone's at ends with the Kingpin.
As long as they don't Deathstroke. Mr. Fisk,
don't
I'll be happy
this
with
to Arrow. Don't compare this to Arrow. Don't compare.
I know.
This
I'm,
Arrow,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
But
they did bring back the major villain from season one, and they did the same thing in Arrow. That's the only reason why I said that.
And then you get that awesome fight scene. It's not really a fight scene between him and Matt, where Matt visits him in prison, and he doesn't know he's Daredevil, but Matt's fucked because now Daredevil, or because now the fucking Kingpin is like investigating Matt Murdock, which. Matt doesn't have the resources to stand up to, especially since he lost all his friends.
Dude, how funny would it be if a Murdoch just started beating the shit out of Mr. Fisk? Like, some blind dude just started beating the shit out of him.
I was super excited because, like, when he threatens fucking Vanessa, who was not shown at all this season, when he threatens her, Fisk just starts choking him out. And then I like that Maddox just fucking headbutts him. And busts his lip because that plays into a later scene where he's eating dinner and he kind of feels the pain. He's like, oh, and then that kind of like reminds him. He's like, oh, he's like, hey, give me all the files on Maddox. That was a
Maddox?
Really cool scene. Yeah,
I love how you just called him.
I thought
Maddox.
We were gonna. I thought that's what we were.
No.
But yeah, okay. but I like that he's so powerful and like we talked about earlier how we stitch a little kid where like he's like, oh, that little fucker bust my lip. Like that's. End his life. I'm curious to how that's gonna play out. I mean, I hope he's the big villain in season 3, or maybe not. I mean, I don't know how long the show's gonna go.
I have a feeling it's probably gonna go for 7 seasons because that seems like the magic number, especially anything that's anything that is gonna be good.
This is different than cable TV, though, man. I know if this was like on CW, you're guaranteed 7 seasons if you make it past season 2. But
yeah, because they're just trying to make money.
Oh yeah. And I mean, because I was talking to Dylan, I didn't know this. They actually cut the budget, like,
for what?
For instance, like every season you go on, the budget gets cut. So like, it was season 2 has a lower budget than season 1, and then 3 lower than season 2, and
which is bullshit.
Going like that, it is bullshit. But the way Dylan like described it, I didn't know, like, because I usually like. You know, I kind of like all the, like the ins and outs and like the behind the scenes, but I guess I just never researched it. But I think that it's
interesting. And it only makes sense because in Arrow, all the fucking battle scenes have become shitty. They don't have yes. They don't have
the
any
fight scenes are because I mean, if you remember Arrow season 1, they have a hallway fight scene even before Daredevil came out. They had a hallway fight scene in Arrow, and it was like a tracking shot, and he was fucking doing the Raid style shit on people in a hallway, and I was like, this is incredible for CW. No, but like the whole logic is he was saying that you already have your built-in audience, so you don't need to spend more money to keep them there. And I'm like, man, that sounds like such a business-like decision that sucks for us fans, but I can't be mad at it from a business perspective, because why the fuck?
And that's why business and art, that's why business and art shouldn't mix. But yeah, and they do, and unfortunately that's just the world we live in.
Like, I guarantee
it,
if we start getting sponsors, I won't be able to call you a cunt anymore, so we're going to have to...
Oh, dude. Again. Yeah. And we can't have that.
No. But I'm excited to see how Fisk plays out in this because, like, his scenes, as brief as they were, him manipulating Punisher and then the whole scene with him and Matt trying to fight back. Because, let's be honest, Matt got lucky at the end of season 1. like, because just like that scene showed, like, Matt was kind of defenseless even after headbutting him. If it's just like a fight, if it's just like a fist on fist fight, he's gonna lose. And if we're not gonna mention it, the season ended with him getting like an upgrade in each season. I lost my shit when he got on the fucking outfit in the last episode. I was cool with the black outfit. I thought it was cool. I was going to be cool with him wearing it forever, because the more it went on, I'm like, this is cool. But seeing him in the suit made me geek out. I liked that they updated it for season two. And then at the end of season two, he gets the fucking billy club. Not only like the billy, and it fucking shoots the fucking cable, so he's swinging around like Batman and Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Oh my, I can't wait for season three. I want it to open up with him just using that on a bunch
of
shit.
So do you think that they will expand or keep the budget the same at the end of, or at the beginning of
I don't think it's
season three?
I don't think this is modeled after basic television. So it's going to stay the same, if not go up.
I would hope so, yeah, for sure. I hope it does.
Netflix has so much money to burn. Like, Netflix is just making so much money hand over fist.
Well, they're getting my $7 a month, or was it 7 or 8?
They're getting
my
brother's $7 a month, I think, and I'm just...
I think they just increased it, though. I think they did. I think they increased the monthly payment, but I think it's only, like, by a dollar, maybe two or something.
Even just for the show, it's fucking worth it.
Yeah. No, it is. It is.
Oh, so man, my battery's running low. I don't have my charger on me. But we're gonna wrap this up anyway. But yeah, no, I loved it. I'm excited to see the Defenders, which is the next time we'll see Daredevil, I assume. We're getting Luke Cage. I don't know if you're in. Are you bought in on this universe? Are you going to watch whatever's connected since you watched Jessica Jones and Daredevil?
I don't know. I mean...
You motherfucker, you just saw one of the best shows ever created, and you're like, I don't know. I mean, dude, you're going to watch it. Because Luke Cage,
Luke Cage is my
favorite part.
If Jessica Jones was at the caliber of Daredevil, then yes, I would.
Yeah.
But
that's such an unfair thing to rate it at, though, man.
It's the same fucking universe and the same fucking producer shit.
No. Actually, it's actually totally different people. That's why I'm excited about their huge
get-together. Oh, okay. I guess I just assumed it was.
No, the people that did Daredevil are doing the Defenders, which is why I'm excited about that, because they handled... Because there's such a quality gap between Jessica Jones and Daredevil. Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, Iron Fist, they all have their different people that are doing it, and then the Defenders are getting the people that did Daredevil, which is who I trust.
Well,
but I'm like, but that I makes mean, me I'm excited for Luke Cage, though. Like, I thought he was one of my favorite parts of Jessica Jones.
Yeah, I mean, when he takes that fucking saw to his stomach, I'm like, oh man, and he's just like, whatever, I don't give a shit.
I just like tearing it up in bed, and she's just like, you can't hurt me, which was actually really cool for them both to be like, oh, we're actually with people that we can't hurt. That's fucking just
yeah. That was actually pretty hot.
That was crazy. Like, what a coincidence that she's the one that killed his wife, though. I was just like, that's kind of corny. I always want to say CW, but like CW and corny mean the same thing, and I don't need to bash CW. But
well, if you look at the one, I think you need to give the 100 a shot, at least the first two seasons. I think you need to give that a shot. I haven't watched season three yet, but it's decent for what it is. It's not up there, but it's better than Jessica Jones.
I'll add it to my list, though.
It's better than Jessica Jones, but not as good as Daredevil. So I'm downplaying it because it's not as good as The Shield. It's not as good as Daredevil. It's not as good as Game of Thrones. But really, what is?
I'm currently going to be watching, when it comes back on, Better Call Saul, Walking Dead, Ash vs. the Evil Dead, Into the Badlands if it comes back. I thought that show was fucking really cool. And then I know there's a shit ton we're missing. We're currently watching Game of Thrones, but like that's about to end. So I mean, we might give 100 like a shot. Like we stated, we both have infants, so our time isn't as I make way too much time for this shit. Like I make more time than I should. I know that I'm like neglecting responsibilities and a wife, but that's neither here or there.
I mean, they'll be there when you get back.
Awesome. So I guess ending thoughts real quick, because I have 7% battery left.
Ending thoughts, go ahead.
Oh, I mean, I can't state how much I fucking love the show. I thought Elektra shit was cool. Stick is cool. I mean, they just, like, they make you care about these characters, and they craft everything so masterfully, and yeah, and I mean, each season wraps up really well. I'm excited to see what Karen thinks now that she's the Rebound, because he was about to run off and leave everything with Elektra, and now he's like, well, she's dead, so maybe I'll reveal my identity to Karen and maybe get together with her. Super dick move, Matt, but I'm excited for season three. And it makes me more excited for the rest of the shows,
I can't blame him, though. I mean, I do the same thing.
Yeah, because you're just like, options. Elektra was hotter. She's dead. You go with the other chick that wants my dick.
And she's an assassin, so, I mean...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, there's so much we didn't touch on, but I'm not going to try to fit on here. It was awesome. I'm looking forward for the Punisher series. I hope that he's a really good character, because I felt like he was such a good supporting character. I hope that he can carry his own show. I'm curious to see, because everybody's story takes place in New York and Hell's Kitchen. I'm curious if the Punisher's going to leave and just go travel and do his thing. That'd be interesting. But if he stays,
I think you would have to, because if you think about it, he's a wanted guy. I mean, he's a wanted man. He's got to go somewhere and do something else.
Didn't do anything wrong. It's all good.
That's true.
But yeah, I don't know. Yeah. What are your last thoughts?
My last thoughts are,